Well, good evening and welcome everyone, and a very, very warm welcome to Harvesting Farm Laws, a legal perspective brought to you by Lex Witness, India's first magazine on legal and corporate affairs. We bring to you in a very, very interesting session on harvesting farm laws, also currently the burning topic, in conversation with Zameer Nathani, Senior Vice President and General Counsel, UFO Movies India Limited. And our guest speaker here is Aditya Shankar, Advocate, Supreme Court of India. We hope all of our attendees are doing well, keeping safe during these times of COVID. And we thank you for joining us for this session on Harvesting Farm Laws, a legal perspective. Well, before I hand it over to Mrs. Zameer Nathani, let me also very briefly introduce you to our host. For all of our audiences here, Mrs. Zameer Nathani is an LLB, LLM, civil, corporate, criminal, customs, international laws, UNWTO, PLD from Harvard Business School, executive MBA from NMIMS, US IP laws from Stanford University, intellectual property rights, and ADR certifications from WIPO, United Nations, private equity from London Business School, and M&A from Harvard Business School again. And Mr. Nathani was a law firm attorney for renowned and global corporates such as the Eureka Forbes, LG Electronics, TCL India, Motul Oils, Ginger Hotels, Kale Consultant Software, Johnson & Johnson, other MNCs from the United States, UK, Asia Pacific, etc. And he was also the Associate Vice President, Reliance Entertainment, Digital Businesses, Global Gaming, OTT, E-Commerce, and Head Legal with Balaji Telefilms, which is India's number one TV show company and OTT, and also Director Legal at Raymond Limited, which is world's largest producer of the worsted suiting fabrics. He's presently Senior Vice President and General Counsel for UFO Movies India Limited, India's pioneering and disruptive technology developer for digital format of all movies and other contents for movie theaters and new OTT and UGC platforms. And I'd also like to tell our audiences that Mr. Nathani is a recipient of the prestigious Harvard Business School Alumni Challenge Award from the Harvard Business School Alumni Achievement Award from Narsi Munji Institute of Management Studies, and in addition to other renowned awards in the past, he is also a recipient of the General Counsel of the Year Award from the Indian National Bar Association at the gracious hands of Justice Shri Krishna, ex-judge, Supreme Court of India, and chairman of the Committee on Data Protection Laws. So welcome, Mr. Nathani, and with that, I will hand over the session to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Samriddhi, and welcome to everyone. Today is a great day for us because we are basically going to discuss the laws which have been widely debated, which has been a center of controversy or not controversy. But point is that today's session we had programmed on the basis of what are the legal provisions which are available. We wanted to see from a lawyer's perspective, from a legal perspective, and therefore the name of the program, Harvesting Farm Laws, a Legal Perspective. The objective of this program was to tell you that this is the law and these are the provisions for it, keeping all other discussions out of it. And therefore, first of all, I would like to welcome everyone to this live session. You are at a live session of the most live subject we have been hearing today in the newspapers. Lex Witness is presenting this program, and we have a learned speaker, Mr. Aditya Shankar Prasad, who's an advocate, Supreme Court of India, and a very acclaimed person, while I read out his introduction to you coming forth. Mr. Aditya Shankar Prasad will take us through the provisions of law under the three farm laws. One is the Bill on Agriculture Market, Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Bill 2020, which is the first law he will speak about it. The second, we will speak about Bill of Contract Farming, which is the Farmer Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price Assurance and Farm Services Bill 2020. And the third law which he will speak about, the bill he will speak about, is the Essential Commodities Amendment Bill 2020. So that's the focus area. And we are purely going to discuss on the legal provisions of it and give certain examples to also portray what is the intent of the legislature by passing of this particular law, all right? But before I go forward, number one, I would like to thank Aditya for the time on this crucial subject matter of farm laws. And I would first like to introduce our distinguished colleague, learned guest, Ms. Sri Aditya Shankar, Advocate Supreme Court of India. Mr. Aditya Shankar is an Advocate Supreme Court of India, Delhi High Court, and Patna High Court, in addition to the other courts where he practices. He is also a founder and partner of the law firm Chambers of Aditya Shankar, or CAS CAS. He has done his LLB from Campus Law Center, Delhi, and LLM from Cornell University, United States. He was also associated with the Chambers of Senior Advocate, Mr. Mukul Rohatgi. He was a standing counsel for State of Madhya Pradesh. He was also a lead partner for Caden Boris Global Delhi, and then managing partner India Litigation and Alternative Dispute Resolution. He's a standing counsel in Supreme Court of India for Chandigarh Housing Board. He's a retainer counsel in Supreme Court of India and Patna High Court for LN Mithila University, Darbhanga. He's also a retainer counsel for Bombay Stock Exchange, BSE, Delhi. Apart from present bar membership of Supreme Court of India, Delhi High Court and Patna High Court, and earlier American Bar Association, Chicago, and New York City Bar Association, he was also honored as a litigation partner, Caden Boris Legal, at Legal 500. And to sum up on his principle of life, as said by him in the words of former US President Abraham Lincoln, "I am for those means which will give the greatest good to the greatest numbers." For giving this introduction, I now want to introduce to you Sri Aditya Shankar Prasad, Advocate Supreme Court of India, who will be speaking to us on harvesting farm laws. Aditya, with this, I hand over to you. Thank you very much once again for your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Sameer. And first of all, a warm and a lovely welcome to all my friends who are watching this great program on Zoom. The times are very strange. In today's times, we have to interact with each other like this. Rather, I would have preferred to come down to one of those institutions and give a lecture there. But unfortunately, due to COVID pandemic, I have to talk to you like this. But I think this is a greater medium because it helps us to interact on a more personal level virtually. So once you interact with somebody virtually, you're also interacting with that person personally also. So I personally feel that even during virtual times, we still have the option to be personal with each other. And with the kind of climate that has been rising in the country regarding the opposition of the farm laws, there is much to decide, discuss and debate. I think that perhaps after the years of independence, and India having firmly evolved as a democracy, the way the entire structure has been in our country all this while, there was a zamindari system and there was a large scale oppression of farmers, the license permit raj which was there, regulation of state, everything. Now perhaps the time has come that the farmers must be given wings to fly. I'm sure many of you would differ from what I say, intellectually, what I think. But I personally feel that with the evolution of times, it is important that there must be a tectonic shift in the way we look at the self-dependency and self-sufficiency of any farmer or a farming setup. Of course, you cannot put everyone at parity because there are big farmers, there are small farmers, there are companies who do contractual farming, there are marginal level farmers who are living on a day-to-day sustenance basis, there are laborers who also double up as farmers. So you cannot have an omnibus vision that a farmer has to maybe see things in a different perspective. But yes, I think there has to be some, I would say, large scale reform that is required in today's time to help the farmer evolve into a more substantive entity. That's how I see it. And by substantive entity, I mean rise of farmer as a financial unit, rise of economic advancement, rise of social empowerment, and rise of political capitalization of that status, of that evolution that comes about. And by political capitalization, I mean that this capitalization has to be carried out in a more dignified way rather than just being aggressive or vocal about without having any logic or rationale to the kind of demands or pressure tactics that is being used. You know, in a country like India, agriculture has dominated a landscape where more than 70% of the population is directly or indirectly involved in agricultural activities. And any government which comes to power, as I understand, has to keep the best interest of the basic supply provider of the country, which is the farmer. Raising crops, tilling the land, selling the produce in the market, generating substantive amount of revenues for self-sustenance. And perhaps the time had come that a new legal architecture was required to give fillip to their aspirations, to give a sense of euphoria, a sense of happiness, a sense of joy that they can negotiate a better price, a better life, and a better social standing in the society that we live in. And therefore, these three new laws that were brought by the government, of course, intellectual differences can be there, but I'm just sharing what I personally believe is going to be a landmark change in the way we look at the farming sector in the country. These three laws, I would say, are equally akin to the 1991 revolution that opened up India's economy. And after opening up of India's economy in 1991, the way foreign companies, multinational corporations, MNCs, as we call them in common parlance, they came, they started delivering better services, better consumer infrastructure was developed, consumer got a larger set of choices. I still remember I was a very young kid and I remember ZTV had just started. For somebody who used to watching Chitrahar every Wednesday on Doordarshan, watching a satellite cable television and listening to latest Bollywood and Hindi songs of those times, I'm talking about 91, 92, 93, when I was substantially young. And the sheer joy of trying to experience something new. So this is how the entire ideation behind these set of laws is designed to take the farming community to greater heights. Now, till now, a lot of issues have dogged the farming community till date. There have been financial constraints in creating rural and semi-rural and farm-based infrastructure. And with the kind of food market that has been growing exponentially in the country, domestically as well as internationally, you know, you have organic food, you have semi-organic food, you have calorie-based food. So the unlike on a very straight jacket formula, the world used to live in maybe say, for example, 35 years back, 40 years back. Now the farming community as a whole has also evolved. And after that, the most important thing, as I understand, is how to encourage corporate infrastructure, better infrastructure, and as well as making substantive positive investment to transform the basic infrastructure and ecosystem of the farming setup. You know, because now the transitionary aspect, that when we speak of India of today and tomorrow, the idea of new India, the idea of Atmanirbhar Bharat, the idea of having India having to celebrate its 75th year of independence in 2022, a new kind of, I would say, architecture is required to effectively shape up the contours by which the farming systems have developed in this country till now. Of course, there are vested interests which are bound to create obstacles everywhere. There are interests which completely, as I understand, are not able to allow some kind of a substantive transformation, as I said earlier, that is going to create, maybe remove all these, I would say, restrictive factors that have been involved till date from the previous times. Might be some vested interests which have been involved. So prior to the evolution of this bill, some basic issues that the farmer community used to regularly face was fragmented markets, insufficient markets, market fees, charges, improper, inadequate infrastructure, post-harvest losses. Say, for example, that there is a overnight snow rain, ola vrishti jo hoti hai, or flood has come, a wildlife animal has come and they have eaten the crops away. Restriction in licensing, the documentary work that is required to clear out the licensing part, high intermediation costs, information asymmetry, lack of proper information on the ground. What is being documented on the top is not being able to reach on the ground. And improper, inadequate credit facilities. The ability to take a loan, the ability to understand and help your business grow on a more substantive level, as well as creating somewhat of a global or a well-known brand or a benchmark to sell the product which you wish to manufacture. Like even say, for example, as I said earlier with a friendly discussion I was having with Zameer, like farmers who sell potatoes to all these big giants like Pringles and Lay's for manufacturing of chips. Now, and these companies, these big farmers who procure these quintals of potatoes from different farmers, they must be having a network of their own. Now the price for which this big farmer is able to negotiate with the bigger company, which is Lay's or whatever, and the amount at which the potato was sold to the big farmer by the smaller farmer, the discrepancy of profit needs to be, I would say, analyzed in that case. And therefore, these three new laws have come. What are these laws? And what is their basic sum and substance? The first law is, as I understand, is the Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion Facilitation Act 2020. Now, what does this law state? I would like to read some provisions. I hope there is substantive time, Zameer, to talk about. Now, what does this law state? Yes, this is the law, as one can see. All right. I have the Gazette of India with me, so it's easier to read from the official. And then one can obviously briefly discuss the entire law. The Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion Facilitation Act 2020, an act to provide for the creation of an ecosystem where the farmers and traders enjoy the freedom of choice relating to sale and purchase of farmers' produce, which facilitates remunerative prices through competitive alternative trading channels to promote efficient, transparent, and barrier-free interstate and intrastate trade and commerce of farmers' produce outside the physical premises of markets or deemed markets notified under various state agricultural produce market legislations to provide a facilitative framework for electronic trading and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. Now, let us read the basic provisions of this law. What does it state? Now, page 2, defines various definitions by which the entire act is to be governed. Electronic trading and transaction platform, this is 2A, means a platform set up to facilitate direct and online buying for and selling of for conduct of trade and commerce of farmers produce through a network of electronic devices and internet applications, where each such transaction results in physical delivery of farmers produce. Who is a farmer as per this act? 2B, farmer means an individual engaged in the production of farmers produce by self or by hired labor or otherwise, and includes the farmer producer organization. C, farmers produce means foodstuff including cereals like wheat, rice or other coarse grains, pulses, edible oil seeds, oils, vegetables, fruits, nuts, spices, sugarcane and products of poultry, piggery, goatry, fishery and dairy intended for human consumption in its natural or processed form. Cattle fodder including oil cakes and other concentrates, raw cotton, etc., etc. And now what is interstate trade? This is 2E. Interstate trade means the act of buying or selling of farmer's produce, wherein a trader of one of the state buys the farmer's produce and from the farmer or a trader of another state, and such farmer's produce is transported to a state other than the state in which the trader purchased such farmer's produce or which such farmer's produce originated. An intrastate trade means the act of buying or selling of farmer's produce, wherein a trader of one state buys the farmer's produce from a farmer or trader of the same state in which the trader purchased such farmer's produce or where such farmer's produce originated. Now the distinction is, one is an intrastate trade and the other is an interstate trade. The intrastate trade means, like say for example, somebody living in Bombay has to sell 100 kilos of tomatoes to somebody living in Nagpur. So that is intrastate trade. And somebody living in Bombay has to sell 100 kilos of tomatoes to somebody living in Ahmedabad is interstate trade. So then various other definitions are there. I would like to come to the salient features. I don't want to go into very, very details, otherwise it can get very gory and boring. But I want to just show what, just to give you a basic summary and understanding of what the law is all about. Now, chapter 2. One definition I'm also reading. State APMC Act means any state registration or union territory registration in force in India by whatever name called, which regulates markets for agricultural produce in that state. Now, this is where the real politics has begun. The main game is of the APMC that is being, that this entire dispute has been created. Now, and also trade area has been defined, trader has been defined. Now, I would like to read chapter 2, which is most important. One can obviously go and research the law and understand what it means. But I want to read the more salient feature of this. Promotion and facilitation of trade and commerce of farmers produce. 3. Subject to the provisions of this act, any farmer trading or electronic trading and transaction platform shall have the freedom to carry on the interstate or intrastate trade and commerce in farmers produce in a trade area. That means any farmer can do any kind of trading, inter or intra. 4.1. Any trader may engage in the interstate trade or intrastate trade of scheduled farmers produce with a farmer or another trader in trade area, provided that no trader except the farmer producer organizations or agricultural cooperative society shall trade in any scheduled farmers produce unless such trader has a permanent account number, which is PAN number, allotted under the Income Tax Act 1961 or other such document as may be notified by the central government. 2. The central government may, if it is of the opinion that it is necessary and expedient in the public interest so to do, prescribe a system for electronic registration for a trader, modalities of trade transaction, and mode of payment of the scheduled farmers produce in scheduled farmers produce in a trade area. Three. Now, why I'm reading this these clauses is that this is the epicenter of the entire dispute of what you see on television today. Every trader who transacts with farmers shall make payment for the traded scheduled farmers produce on the same day within maximum 3 working days, if procedurally so required, subject to the condition that the receipt of delivery mentioning the due payment amount shall be given to the farmer on the same day, provided that the central government may prescribe a preferred procedure of payment by farmer produce organization or agricultural cooperative society by whatever name called, linked with the receipt of payment from the buyers. This is a very important clause. I will explain why it is important. Let me just first read the provision. Any person, this is other than individual, having a permanent account number allotted under the Income Tax Act 1961 or such other document as may be notified by the central government or any farmer producer organization or agricultural cooperative society, may establish and operate an electronic trading and transaction platform for facilitating interstate or intrastate trade and commerce of scheduled farmers produce in a trade area, provided that the person establishing and operating an electronic trading and transaction platform shall prepare and implement the guidelines for fair trade practices. This is important. Fair trade practices such as mode of trading, fees, technical parameters, including interoperability with other platforms, logistics arrangements, quality assessment, timely payment, dissemination of guidelines in local language of the place of operation of the platform, and such other matters. If the central government is of the opinion that it is necessary and expedient in public interest so to do for electronic trading platforms, by rule, specify the procedure, norms, manner of registration, B, specify the code of conduct, technical parameters, including interoperability with other platforms and modalities of trade transaction, including logistics, arrangement, and quality assessment of the scheduled farmers, produce and mode of payment for facilitating fair interstate and intrastate trade and commerce of scheduled farmers produced in a trade area. No market fee or cess or levy by whatever name called under any state APMC or under any state law shall be levied on any farmer or trader or electronic trading and transaction platform for trade and commerce in scheduled farmers produced in a trade area. The central government may, through central government organization, develop a price information market intelligence system for farmers produce and a framework for dissemination of information relating thereto. The central government, this is seven, clause 7.2. The central government may require a person, any person owning and operating an electronic trading and transaction platform to provide information regarding such transactions as may be prescribed. Explanation: for the purpose of this section, the expression central government organization includes any subordinate or attached office, government owned or government promoted. Now, what is the sum and substance of this entire provision? Try and understand what I'm trying to highlight. Number one, this provision firstly creates a free and a fair level ground for initiating free trade practices when it comes to selling and purchasing of a produce made by a farmer. Number two, it is done on an interoperability basis. Parties can intersee vis-a-vis each other, can transact, can also travel, can also sell a produce outside the state, outside the mandi. And to be eligible to sell the produce, you must have a basic PAN card. That's the only requirement under the Income Tax Act. Wow. You don't need to be a registered vendor. You don't have to be bound by the APMC. The APMC cannot be a regulatory body which is trying to act like an ostrich, trying to hover around you, that you have to go through them only. And this is where the conflict is. And if somebody who is to sell the product on an electronic platform has to register on that particular electronic platform, which is mandated by the government of India, by the central government. Like say, for example, an e-Naam platform is there, in which an ordinary kisan can go and put his entire produce on the web, asking for a fair bargain, for a fair price, for a fair selling amount. And as a result of which, he gets a completely clear-cut understanding as to how this entire picture comes about. Now, the act basically allows the farmers to trade in outside trade area, such as farm gates, factory premises, cold storages, and so on. There is no foundation as such that you have to go to APMC, you have to just go to the mandi only, and some 5-6 people will be there trying to regulate your deal for you, trying to sell your product to some other third party. And apart from that, it also helps to facilitate lucrative prices for the farmers via alternative trading methods. It breaks down the barrier between interstate trade and intrastate trade vis-a-vis the agricultural produce.
Aditya, we have one question which is coming in, because you are trying to put, you are trying to say that the law covers that, you know, you are not restricted to only one platform like APMC, for example.
Yeah.
And there is a freedom in that sense. So first question is that we are getting a lot of questions offline also.
I have an answer. Can I answer all the questions in the end?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So we'll keep it step by step. You can proceed.
I just need to complete. These acts are quite
big. Yes, yes, yes. And just, we'll ask the audience to be also patiently testing us. We'll take it at the end.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm not running away, but let's do it in the end.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So electronic trading has been given a fillip. You are given a platform to market your produce. You're also given a platform to sell what is appropriately to be sold in an international market, in a domestic market. Say, for example, somebody sitting all the way in Tamil Nadu can sell agriculture produce in UP. You don't have to operate within the confines of that particular mandi or that state only or that district only. And the absence of any specified area to facilitate trade via online buying and through electronic devices is, I think, a landmark development for the advancement of a common farmer. Now, state governments are also being prohibited to levy market fees or cess on farmers. And all these electronic platforms for trading farmers' produce are to be covered under outside trade area. Now, the basic issue that arises for consideration here is, and I think this will answer many questions which people would like to ask me, कि MSP का क्या होगा, मिनिमम सपोर्ट प्राइस, एंड विल प्रोक्योरमेंट फ्रॉम MSP स्टॉप? नो, MSP वॉज देयर, इज देयर, एंड विल ऑलवेज बी देयर. द गवर्नमेंट डज नॉट इंटेंड टू अबॉलिश द MSP एट ऑल. इट्स अ मिसनमर दैट हैज बीन क्रिएटेड एवरीवेयर दैट द MSP इज बीइंग अबॉलिश्ड बिकॉज देयर आर लिस्टेड आइटम्स by which the government has been giving minimum grants. And nobody is abolishing the mandis. The legislation does not state that the mandis are to be abolished by way of promulgation of this particular act. It simply gives the farmer a better and a larger choice to negotiate for his products at a different level. It helps that farmer to achieve a full potential which in ordinary cases, the mandi would not have been able to bargain that price for him. Of course, there might be aberrations everywhere, but the intent behind this legislation is principally to empower the farmer. And say, for example, if a farmer can sell their products, produce at minimum MSP rates, they are also subject to approach the mandis if they feel that they will get a better price there. There is no foundation that a farmer has to do independent trading only. There is no coercive option that the farmer has to go to mandi only. And there is also the lack of third option, which is a flexible option that the farmer can at his own will exercise, that whether the product is to be sold digitally or through other mediums. So therefore, the fact that this particular law will help in the accelerating of market-based goods through digital platforms, which, as I foresee, with the kind of economy that India is becoming gradually, will scale up. So this is going to be a landmark change in the entire structure. Now, the third chapter of this law is, I'll just do a brief summary because I have to go to other two laws as well. I don't want to go into the details very much of it, is the dispute resolution system. Now, a board of conciliation has also been formed, which will be consisting of a chairperson and not less than two members, including the SDM, who will be supervising the control. And the members will be appointed in equal number, a huge amount. There is also provision for penalty. There is a provision for order of recovery if there is a false recovery, and several the bureaucratic setups have also been created, which is the suspension or cancellation of right to operate in electronic trading and transaction platform. Now, what is this? I want to read this part. The Agriculture 9-1, the Agriculture Marketing Advisor, Director of Marketing and Inspection, Government of India, or an officer of the state government to whom such powers are delegated by the central government in consultation with the respective state government, may on its own motion or on a petition or on the reference from any government agency, take cognizance of any breach of the procedures, norms, manner of registration and code of conduct, or any breach of the guidelines for fair trade practices by electronic trading and transaction platform established under Section 5 or contravenes the provision of Section 7, and by an order within 60 days from the date of receipt and for the reasons to be recorded only. He may pass an order of recovery for the amount payable to the farmers and traders, impose a penalty as stipulated in subsection 2 of section 11, or suspend for such period as he deems fit, or cancel the right to operate as an electronic trading and transaction platform, provided that no order of recovery of amount of penalty or suspension of cancellation of right to operate shall be passed without giving the operator of such electronic trading and transaction platform an opportunity of being heard. Now, the law is very clear. There is also provision for cancellation of the entire electronic platform. The right to file an appeal is there, and notice will also be served. Penalties are there, and there are very other provisions that how the entire act is to apply and what are the protection is to be taken in good faith. The act is to have an overriding effect vis-a-vis the relationship with the state APMC, because what this act is trying to do is, it is basically trying to fundamentally give an option to the farmer to also override the state APMC. And that's where the real problem is, because the state APMC till now, from all these years post-independence, has been the fulcrum of the farmer's selling capability. And since these three laws intend to change all of that, that's why this entire set of protests is happening. And apart from that, there is also other set of rules which one would like to go into. But the larger sum and substance, as I said earlier, is free trade. The right to sell your produce to a bigger purchaser. And apart from that, helping you to evolve more in terms of understanding the knack of your own independent business. That what is best for your business, basically having the luxury of more options, approaching the state APMC, doing online trading, contacting a corporate for contractual farming, which I would say has also been twisted out of sight and out of mind for vested reasons. But the variety of options to make the life of a farmer better is laid down in this law. Now, coming to the next act. Yeah. This is another important act. The Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement on Price Assurance and Farm Services Act 2020. What does it state? And what is the basic objective behind this act? Let's read the preamble of this act. The objective. An act to provide for a national framework on farming agreements that protects and empowers farmers to engage with agribusiness firms, processors, wholesalers, exporters, or large retailers for farm services and sale of future farming produce at a mutually agreed remunerative price framework. Please note the word mutually agreed remunerative price framework in a fair and transparent manner and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. Now, this is where the entire set of dispute that has been given now in chapter 2 talks about a farming agreement. Now, what is a farming agreement? Let's read that. A farmer may enter into a written farming agreement in respect of any farming produce, and such agreement may provide for A, the terms and conditions for supply of such produce, including the time of supply, quality, grade, standards, price, and such other matters, and B, the terms related to supply of farm services, provided that the responsibility for compliance of any legal requirement for providing such farm services shall be with the sponsor or the farm service provider, as the case may be. No farming agreement. This is the most important point. May kindly see it. 2.3.1.3.2. No farming agreement shall be entered into by a farmer under this section in derogation of any rights of a sharecropper. Now, what does this imply? Who is a sharecropper? A sharecropper is a basic tiller of the land. Now, say for example, if X is a sharecropper who's trying to sell a produce which he has tilled for to a farmer for which he is working, any agreement that is conducted by such a farmer must not be in derogation of the rights of the basic tilling rights of the farmer. He must not feel cheated. He must not feel exploited. He must not feel that the produce that he has tried to raise has been purchased at an unfair deal. The bargaining rights have been compromised with. And if you read the entire explanation Now, this chapter two is a very long chapter, but it is the most important because this is where the dispute is arising regarding contractual farming. So I will have to explain this in a more detailed fashion. Explanation. For the purpose of this subsection, the term sharecropper means a tiller or occupier of a farm land who formally or informally agrees to give fixed share of crop or to pay fixed amount to the land owner for growing or rearing of farming produce. Three, the minimum period of the farming agreement shall be for one crop season or one production cycle of livestock, as the case may be, and the maximum period shall be 5 years, provided that where the production cycle of any farming produce is longer and may go beyond 5 years, in such case, the maximum period of farming agreement may be mutually decided by the farmer and the sponsor and explicitly mentioning in the farming agreement. Four, for the purpose of facilitating farmers to enter into written farming agreements, the central government may issue necessary guidelines along with model farming agreements in such manner as it deems fit. Now, what does this law state? It basically creates a base benchmark to ensure that the tiller on the lowest common denominator is not feeling cheated or exploited. Because once a farming agreement is to be made, say for example, between a contractual company or a corporate company or somebody else, the farming agreement must be for one crop season. It cannot be terminated at will. Now, say for example, if one crop season is for 3 months, then the agreement must carry over for 3 months. It cannot be, or for one production cycle of a livestock, say for example, you are rearing cows to produce large scale milk for market consumption. So if any company intends to purchase milk from the producer of that particular milk, which in this case is the farmer who is working, say for example, he has 20 cows and he's giving wholesale milk to this dairy company. Now the agreement cannot be arbitrarily terminated. It has to have at least the completion of, as expected, as per the law, is of a basic cycle of livestock. And to protect the rights of the farmer, model agreements will also be given on time to time basis by the central government. Now, this is slightly long, but I want to just tell the essential elements of this law. Otherwise, we can go into maximum detail and that will take a lot of time. And then the quality grades and standards of farming produce have also to be maintained. What does the law state on this? The parties entering into a farming agreement may identify and require as a condition for the performance of such agreement compliance with mutually acceptable quality grade and standards of farming produce. Mark the words, mutually acceptable quality grade and standards of farming produce. It cannot be substandard. Two, for the purposes for which of subsection 1, the parties may adopt the quality grade and standards A, which are compatible with agronomic practices, agroclimate, and such other factors, or B, formulated by any agency of the central government or the state government or any agency authorized by such government for this purpose, and explicitly mention such quality grade and standards in the farming agreement. So what does the farming agreement do? It has to mention the quality, grade, as well as the standard of the produce that is thought to be purchased or sold via this farming agreement. And it is also accordingly responsible for this pesticide residue, food standard safety, good farming practices, including good labor and social development standards. Everything has to be well defined and explicitly clear in the farming agreement. And as a result of which, there has to be an assessment during the process of cultivation or rearing by third parties who are qualified assayers or to ensure there is impartiality and fairness. Now, where does this hamper the interest of the ordinary kisan? It does not. Rather, it creates an effective benchmark for him to sell his produce on a more competitive level so that he can fetch a higher price for the produce that he's selling. And the now coming to the pricing part, here is the question of disagreement which these people are agitating on the roads. The price to be paid for the purchase of a farming produce may be determined and mentioned in the farming agreement itself. And in case such price is subject to variation, then such agreement shall explicitly provide for. The agreement must explicitly define how the price is to vary. A guaranteed price to be paid for such produce, which in this case is MSP, or which they are asking from the government, or B, a clear price reference for any additional amount over and above the guaranteed price, including bonus or premium, to ensure best value to the farmer. Mark the words, best value to the farmer. And such price reference may be linked to the prevailing prices in specified APMC yard or electronic trading and transaction platform or any other suitable benchmark prices, provided that the method of determining such price or guaranteed price or additional amount shall be annexed to the farming agreement. So what does this clause say? Number one, there has to be a determined price which is to decide the sale of that particular product. Even if the in the agreement itself, even if the price is subjected to variation, the agreement shall explicitly provide for that a basic minimum price is to be paid in the case of a variation vis-a-vis that produce or that product which is likely to be sold as per the terms and conditions of the farming agreement. And bonus and premium is also to be given so that best value to the farmer is given. And apart from that, the valuation of the entire product, including the one that is specified in the APMC, is also to be considered on electronic platforms. They must clearly define, specify what prices are these products being sold for and what is the likely profit that is likely to be accrued, including grant of bonuses and premiums to the farmer so that his self-esteem and self-worth remains intact. The next is the sale of farm purchase and farming produce. Now, that is a very understood thing, that how you can sell and you can produce at the price, which are, because basic issue is the price. Otherwise, the APMCs are overruled. They were the option. Now they are an option, a option. So that way, which I've already mentioned, because many of things are repetitive also. Now, a very interesting clause which has been given in this act is two, three things, because this law covers a lot of points, which I'd like to highlight very briefly. The sponsors are also regarding the Yes. Sale or purchase of farming produce. Where under a farming agreement, the delivery of any farming produce is to be A, taken by the sponsor at the farm gate. He shall take such delivery within the agreed time. B, effected by the farmer, it shall be the responsibility of the sponsor to ensure that all preparations for the timely acceptance of such delivery have been made. And the most interesting part, which I'd like to say, is the sponsor shall A, where the farming agreements relate to seed production, where the farming agreement relates to seed production, make payment of not less than 2/3 of agreed amount. So, aadha paisa pehle de dena hai at the time of delivery, and the remaining amount after due certification, but not later than 30 days of delivery. So, effective steps have been taken to give substantive remuneration for the produce that is being generated by an ordinary farmer. And there are some exemptions that have also been given. This part, one clause I'd like to read, which is very important regarding the ownership of the land. Sponsor prohibited from acquiring ownership rights or making permanent modifications on farmers' land or premises. लोगों में ये डर बिठाया जा रहा है कि हमारी जमीनें छीन ली जाएंगी, हम रोड पे आ जाएंगे, वी विल कम ऑन द रोड, आवर लैंड विल बी टेकन अवे. व्हाट डज द लॉ सेट ऑन दिस? लेट्स रीड इट. दिस इज एन इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट, सो आईड लाइक टू रीड दिस. नो फार्मिंग अग्रीमेंट शैल बी एंटर्ड इनटू फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ ए एनी ट्रांसफर इंक्लूडिंग सेल, लीज एंड मॉर्गेज ऑफ द लैंड और प्रीमाइसेस ऑफ द फार्मर, और बी raising any permanent structure or making any modification on the land or premises of the farmer, unless the sponsor agrees to remove such structure or to restore the land to its original condition at his cost on the conclusion of the agreement or expiry of the agreement period, as the case may be, provided that where such structure is not removed as agreed by the sponsor, the ownership of such structure shall vest with the farmer after conclusion of the agreement or expiry of the agreement period, as the case may be. 9. A farmer agreement may be linked with insurance or credit instrument under any scheme of the central government or the state government or any financial service provider to ensure risk mitigation and flow of credit to farmer or sponsor or both. Now, what does this state? You cannot illegally acquire the land which does not belong to you. You cannot make ownership claims by making any kind of alteration or by trying to impose a structure within the land or trying to do something differential which creates a perception that the land belongs to you. And in case if you do, you are bound by the law to restore the land to your original condition. That means the law is very clear on this point, that there has to be originality of the land in case some illegality has been found, for which, failing which, penalties will be levied on you, including the other IPC and other provisions of law that might take substantive application thereafter. And other parties to farming agreement also states that an aggregator or farm service provider may become a party to the farming agreement, and in such case, the role and services of such aggregator or farm service provider shall be explicitly mentioned in such farming agreement. A, for the purposes of this section, aggregator means any person, including a farmer producer organization, FPO, who acts as an intermediary between a farmer or a group of farmers and a sponsor, and provides aggregation related services to both farmers and sponsors. And two, farm service provider means any person who provides farm services. Now, even a third party who is negotiating on behalf of the farmer with a third, with a intended sponsor or a purchaser or a deal maker, is also covered by the application of this particular agreement, and including those individuals who are also giving farm services, where the farmer is tilling his land. Let's say, for example, if I take a farm on farmland on lease, and then I till the land there, and then I sell the produce. So everything is being covered for. But the most important point is, at any time after entering into a farming agreement, the parties to such agreement may, with mutual consent, alter or terminate such agreement for any reasonable cause. So, by mutual consent, if things are not working out, you also have the option to terminate the agreement. And this also includes the constitution and composition of the powers of the registration authority also. There is a dispute settlement clause as well. Other clauses can also be read because I don't want to take much time. And apart from that fact, the entire dispute settlement process in this case is a three-level dispute settlement process. Conciliation board, SDM, and then an appellate authority. So at every level, the government has made effective provisions to ensure that the interest of the ordinary kisan is taken care of. Minimum period also has been given by the government, which I said earlier. Maximum period also has been given. And the best part is, no matter what people might say or decry, everybody is entitled to have their own opinion. But the fact that the agreement is likely to mention the amount of price at which the basic transaction is happening is, I think, a salient feature. That in case, if minimum amount of price is not guaranteed, then a basic price cannot be vitiated by which the farmer has to be compensated. So this entire politics over MSP takes a hit. And I will explain what the problem with them is also, what they want and what the law is saying. And many issues are being raised. Issues about contract farming, that how the farmers will come under pressure, big companies will be at an advantage, and the kind of hullabaloo that is being created. But I'd like to make it very, very clear that the farmer will have the power to completely fix the contract for a fixed sale price of his choice for the produce, within which they will receive payment within 3 days. 3 din ke andar paisa milega. 10,000 farmer producer organizations have been formed over the country who will work together with small farmers, bring them together to ensure remunerative pricing for farm produce. And the real problem is that after signing the contract, the farmer will not be required to seek out traders to sell their produce. So somebody like me who wants to go buy a set of 2 kilos of guava, I can directly go to the farmer's produce and buy it from him, rather than going to a mandi or going to some other shop and trying to seek my set of fruits from there. And the fact that an alternative dispute resolution mechanism has been created has also been done to avoid the process of court. Although court can be an option in case if there is an agreement. For the enforceability of the agreement, then separate proceedings under the Contract Act will start applying. And that's a different story. Because farming agreement is also a contract. It's a contractual obligation. Then I want to read the last act and then make my concluding remarks, because otherwise this can go on and on. Otherwise, my learned friends who are sitting with me and watching this program can also go and research on what the other provisions of the law is. What I'm basically trying to do is I'm trying to give a brief, holistic overview of what the acts are, of what this act is all about. And
we can sit you as long as you want.
No.
We're getting it.
Zameen sir, we're getting a lot of offline questions. Should we post them here itself for you or?
No, you can put it. I'm also getting it. Aditya, you can continue.
Sure. Thank you.
I would also just
summarize.
Speed up my assessment of the laws.
Take your time.
Yeah. Now, the third law is the Essential Commodities Amendment Act 2020. What does this state? Now, the Essential Commodities Act is a product of the Essential Commodities Act 1955. What does it state? I'm just reading out very briefly. I don't want to go in the details of this long objective. Article 369 of the Constitution had empowered the Parliament during a period of 5 years from the commencement of the Constitution to make laws with respect to trade and commerce and in and the production, supply, and distribution of certain essential commodities. The life of the Essential Supplies Temporary Powers Act 1946 was therefore limited to 26 January 1955. It was in public interest that central government should continue to have the same legislative powers even after 26 January 1955, a bill providing for the necessary amendment of Entry 33 of List 1 in the 7th Schedule to the Constitution was passed by both Houses of Parliament. The Constitution Third Amendment Act had, however, not become law when the Essential Supplies Temporary Powers Act 1946 expired, and therefore an ordinance was promulgated to take effect on the 26th day of January 1955. provide for the control of production, supply, and distribution of and trade and commerce in certain commodities. Under Article 369 of the Constitution, Parliament had power during a period of 5 years from the commencement thereof to make laws with respect to trade and commerce in and the production, supply, and distribution of certain essential commodities. Now, what were these commodities during that time? Coal, textile, iron, steel, paper, which are products of industries under union control, and foodstuffs, cattle, fodder, etc., which are not products of such industries. Now, there is a long explanation that has been given. And what this law in 55, which at the time when it was promulgated, stated: the present bill seeks to replace the central ordinance and at the same time includes within the definition of essential commodities those commodities which had to be left out by reason of lack of legislative power. To a very large extent, the bill follows the provision contained in the Essential Supplies Temporary Powers Act 1946, but the penalty clause has been simplified and a few other provisions have been omitted as unnecessary. Now, this law basically helped in the promulgation of essential commodities that were required for functioning of India as a nation. The food commodities, postal services, police services, other things, many other things, coal, textile, steel. And what this law does is that the power to regulate or deregulate, the power to regulate or deregulate the sale and purchase of these essential basic commodities is vested in the central government or the state government for that matter. A small example is sometimes postal employees go on strike, or if there is an emergency in the country, large scale hoarding happens. Now, at the onset of the corona lockdown, when people got scared as if some big giant Armageddon was happening in the on the planet, everybody went to the stores to start stocking up. Ki saman rakh lo, pata nahi kab mauka milega nahi milega. To is tarah ke paristhiti mein, in these type of situations, the government has the power to regulate or deregulate the pricing as well as enforce the act so that essential supplies are always remaining available at the price mandated by the government. Now, what this Amendment Act has done is, the 2020 Essential Commodities Amendment Act, it has completely freed food grains, pulses, edible oils and onion for trade, except in extraordinary crisis situations. What do you read in contractual law as force majeure, things beyond our control? Like say, for example, if there is large scale flooding or large scale outbreak of a virus or earthquake and people are trying to hoard prices, they're trying to steal away essential supplies given by the government to all these ration and kirana shops, the PDS shops, public distribution systems shops. Now, the government also has the power to regulate and deregulate the pricing thereafter, vis-a-vis which has to be followed, following which, if you don't follow, penal action will be initiated against you. So it's a strict act in applying, in appliance, as well as implementation. And to ensure that this entire intent behind the promulgation of these laws remains strong. Let me just read. Clause 2 of the new amended act. What does it state? In section 3 of the Essential Commodities Act 1955, after subsection 1, the following subsections shall be inserted, namely 1A. Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1A, the supply of such foodstuffs, including cereals, pulses, potato, onions, edible oil seeds, and oils, as the central government may by notification in the official gazette specify, may be regulated only by under extraordinary circumstances, which may include war, famine, extraordinary price rise, and natural calamity of grave nature. So, accepting what used to be the essential commodity before the promulgation of this law has been removed by the central government after this law came into nature. Exception only when extraordinary circumstances intervene, that will the government take proactive steps to regulate or deregulate them. And then B, any action on the imposing stock limit shall be based on price rise, and an order for regulating stock limit of any agricultural produce may be issued under this act only if there is 100% increase in the retail price of horticultural produce, or 2, 50% increase in the retail price of non-perishable agricultural foodstuffs over the period prevailing immediately preceding 12 months, or average retail price of last 5 years, whichever is lower. Provided that such order for regulating stock limit shall not apply to a processor of value chain, participant of any agricultural produce, if the stock limit of such person does not exceed the overall ceiling of installed capacity of processing or the demand for export in case of an exporter. Provided further that nothing contained in this subsection shall apply to any order relating to the public distribution system or the targeted public distribution system made by the government under this act or under any other law for the time being in force. Now, what this basically amendment does is, now, as per the law, this 1955 Act, the central government regulates the production, supply, and distribution of a whole host of commodities which it declares essential in order to make them available to the consumer at fair prices. And it also has the power to fix a basic MRP when the need arises and can take them off the list once the situation improves. Also, if a commodity is in shortfall or short supply, and the government sees that the price of that commodity is spiking, is arbitrarily increasing, the government can notify stock holding limits on it for a specified period of time. And vis-a-vis when it comes to state government and what are the powers, the state government can also choose not to impose any restriction as notified by the center. What, as I understand, in constitutionally, it is called cooperative federalism. That every initiation has to be done at the behest of the center and the state on a jointly basis. The center can defy, the state can defy, but the center will obviously have overruling our power. And if the restrictions are imposed, traders have to immediately sell any stock beyond the mandated quantity in the market, only with the purpose of improving the supply as well as bringing down the prices. Now, as I said earlier, the nature of this amendment is that what used to be basic essential commodity prior to the promulgation of this amendment as an act was always considered a basic commodity. Dal, sabzi, aloo, pyaaj, edible oil, vanaspati. Now these are basic day-to-day items which are required to run a household in this country. Of which many commodities have been substantially deregulated. And what the law states is that the imposition of any stock limit on agricultural produce will be based on price rise and can only be imposed if there is a 100% increase in the retail price of horticultural produce. That means the price has to take a sharp jump organically, and 50% increase in the retail price of non-perishable agricultural food items. That means that non-perishable food items price can only rise by 50% if the situation improves. But not when there is a crisis, when there is a famine, there is a situation which is completely out of sync with an organic day-to-day Indian life. And the increase over a period of these prices, as the government says, over the price prevailing has to be done by a period preceding 12 months. It cannot be arbitrarily ki nahi aaj isko itna badha do, aaj 5 rupaye ka hai kal 50 rupaye ka bana do. The entire calculation has to be done on a substantive basis over a period of time, for which minimum criteria is that it must be observed over a period of 12 months. And these restrictions will not be applied to food or stocks of food held for public distribution in India, only in exceptional cases. So, what this bill basically seeks to envisage, these three bills, is that, just to conclude my arguments, because otherwise this will go on, and I want to address the MSP issue at the end. We'll take 2 minutes for that as well. Right. And then I'm open to questions after that.
Okay.
And then what this basically the law states is that the farmers, insofar as they have an option and the freedom to sell their produce outside the APMC, there will be no tax on such trade, which will give higher price to the farmers. So if a farmer is getting a higher price, other than the APMC, it will not be subjected to tax. No restriction is there on the sale of produce to any part of the land, anywhere in this land. And the farmers are at a liberty to sell their produce to any merchant they wish to sell, wherever they get a better and a higher price, a fair price, a reasonable price for the product that they are selling. No license is required for trading to purchase the agricultural produce of farmers in the trade area other than the APMC mandi. So if X purchases tomatoes from Y, he will not require a license to purchase from Y. And the only requirement, as I said earlier, is a PAN card and nothing else. Matter is to be settled in case of a dispute within 30 days by the SDM. And there is also provision for heavy penalty of violation of rules and regulation. So in overall, this entire law, as I said earlier, gives the farmer a flexibility to negotiate a better life. It gives them the financial wherewithal to create a better future for themselves, including creating a better infrastructure for the breeding of their produce as well as the sale of their produce. Now, coming to the MSP issue, which I want to address. Now, there is an apprehension among the farmers, those who are protesting, that allowing outside the APMC trade of farm producers would lead to lesser buying by the government agency in the approved mandis. That this would make the entire MSP irrelevant, which is not the case. The law effectively did, once I was reading the law, did the law ever state that you ban the mandis? The law never said that. The law just gives the farmer a better option to negotiate for him in a better climate, a better business opening. And the entire politics behind this MSP products produces that for every, now, if you start giving MSP for every single product that is being grown in this country, then the government will approximately have to pay 16 to 17 lakh crore every year to give MSP to these farmers, if one goes by their demand. And with great sense of respect, I must tell you, India today is not in a position to afford the large-scale disbursal of its state-owned money, because we are a growing country. We need better infrastructure. We need better healthcare. We need better roadways, railways. Where will the money come from? And suppose if farmers start demanding money as an MSP for cash crops like coffee, the state cannot afford it. I'll give you a basic example. People might differ with me. But say, for example, if wheat is being produced at the rate of 100 rupees per quintal and some unforeseen situation happens, rain comes and destroys the crop, and the crop is not worth more than 30 rupees quintal, will the government still be entitled to pay 100 rupees per quintal at the loss of 70 rupees? Because it has to pander to certain vested interests? No. That is not the answer. And recently, the government had set up a committee, the Shanta Kumar Committee, to examine the benefit of MSP to the farmers in 2015. And the committee gave a report that only 6% farmers benefit from the MSP regime, because farmers by nature are entrepreneurial. and the control of these mandis over the farming community, including the vested interest in politics that comes along with it, creates obstructions for an ordinary farmer. The problem with Punjab and Haryana is that in these states, MSP has worked well. 75 to 80% paddy has been procured by the state. So that gives them a cushioning ground. And once this MSP is withdrawn, then this entire structure that has been built all these years will crumble. And that's why this vocal approach has been taken, an aggressive approach has been taken to completely ensure that the MSP remains, which the government has to see the larger interest. So therefore, I would like to conclude now, and I hope I've been, I was able to give an effective assessment of the laws that I believe are going to change India's future for tomorrow, with a better hope that the ordinary farmer will get a long-standing due, which has not been given to him till date. And with the promulgation of laws, of course, one is equally open to debate and discuss and have a different view from what the view I take. But I see, all in all, this law as a game changer for India's agricultural sector. My only answer is that can a farmer put a board outside that no contract farming allowed? If, say, for example, an XYZ company wants to come and do business with me, and because I have to secure my interest, so should I put an agreement? Should I put a board that no contractual, no corporates allowed, no farming allowed, contractual farming allowed? So that is detrimental to my interest. Yes. Issue here is that whatever agreement is made, basic minimum price has to be given to me within 3 days. And that the law itself has mandated, which I said earlier. Thank you so much. It was wonderful interacting with the team of Lex Witness and my dear friend Zameer for giving me this opportunity and give an assessment of this law. I think I've taken enough time of yours.
Excellent.
So I'm extremely grateful to all of you for going through this excruciating session. And I hope to see you guys again sometime soon. I'm open to questions. Please ask me questions now.
Yes, please. We would like to really thank you from the bottom of our heart, because, you know, we have been reading the newspapers. We have been reading the debate. We wanted to understand, as lawyers or the community, to understand what are the laws and what is the intent behind it. All right. Yeah. And this was given, I think, first time by you on this panel with Lex Witness. We are really thankful to you.
Thank you, Zameer. We wanted
the audience to know, because if you see otherwise the point, we wanted the audience to first know what is the law and what are the provisions which are made inside it, because all other things are the narratives which are there on the newspapers.
Actually, what happens is that many people who don't understand the law and the legal architecture, including the ones going on television debates, including some of the news people, they don't understand the legal implication of what the act has really said.
Yes.
And if they understand what the intent of the act is, that will clear out. Of course, the act is subject to interpretation, because the law has been promulgated. No effective transaction till date has been reported. That the after the promulgation of this act, that a new set of transaction has been reported. So of course, there is going to be ki ye ho jayega, wo ho jayega, phanana ho jayega, hum road pe aa jayenge. तो भारत में ये सब चलता है, लेकिन किसी चीज के बारे में ओपिनियन बनाने के पहले आपको उसको पढ़ के समझना चाहिए कि उसके पीछे की मंशा क्या है.
Absolutely. And that was the objective, because we did not wanted to have the debates which are on channel, because our channel was Lex Witness. Yeah. And we wanted the audience to see witness the law, because Lex Witness means witness the law. And you did that for us. There are some live questions. We have come in. Okay. So many questions have come in. Good questions are there.
Yeah.
The first question is, will marginal and small farmers benefit from these laws as these protests are being held from particular state? I think we'll keep it to legal portion of it. Aditya, you can only answer on, will the marginal and small farmers benefit from these laws?
I will answer all the questions in my own style, no problem.
Yes, sir.
So, see, I don't know how much you saw my session, but the law explicitly provides an effective platform for the farmer to negotiate his price, including the minimum support price, which is likely to get from a potential buyer. And the price and the quality of the product is to be determined as per the farming agreement. And the money is to be delivered within a period of 3 days. Even if you, like, I'm a lawyer, I practice law. Today, if a client engages me and if I send him an invoice to make my payment, he also takes 10 days to make payment. The government here is legally mandating the right of a farmer to be protected financially, including bonuses and payment of money.
So it's an obligation to pay within 3 days.
Of course, the law says it.
Okay. So this is the, it's not only the MSP, it's the guarantee also, which they get.
Wait, let me read out that provision for you. It will clear you out. For my dear friend who asked me that question.
Right.
Let me read it out for you. Just a second. It's important that, see this. This is written farming agreement. Can you see farming agreement here?
Yes.
Farming agreement?
Yes.
Okay. Wait. I just want to... Where is the... I just read it right now. Yeah.
But I think the 3 days is very important. In fact, this must not be under the existing system also. So 3 days is nothing. I mean, so that this type of a guarantee itself under the law, I think it's an obligatory because you can't override by a contract.
That's what I'm saying. So you have to decide within a period of 3 days, the payment has to be done. Okay. And that is the farming agreement that states.
Okay.
Let me just read that. Yes.
Okay.
So this is chapter 2. You see chapter 2. Promotion and facilitation of farmers trade and produce. Do you see chapter 2 here, written here?
Yes, we can see that.
Right. Now come to clause 4, sub clause 3. Let me read it out for you. Sub clause 4. Again, just to clear out this point. Any trader may engage in the interstate trade or intrastate trade of scheduled farmers' produce with a farmer or another trader in a trade area, provided that no trader except the farmer producer organizations or agricultural cooperative society shall trade in any scheduled farmers' produce unless such a trader has a permanent account number allotted under the Income Tax Act 1961 or such other document as may be notified by the central government. So all you require is an Aadhaar card or a PAN card or something just to do any valid transaction.
Wow.
Number two, central government may, if it is of the opinion that it is necessary and expedient in the public interest so to do, prescribe a system for electronic registration of a trader. So you electronically register yourself also.
Right.
Modalities of trade transaction and mode of payment of the scheduled farmers produce in trade area. This is clause 2. Now come to clause 4.3. This is where the question will be answered. Every trader who transacts with farmers shall make payment for the traded scheduled farmers produce on the same day. Okay. On the same day, within the maximum 3 working days, if procedurally so required, subject to the condition that the receipt or delivery mentioning the due payment amount shall be given to the farmer on the same day.
Oh, wonderful.
provided that the federal government may prescribe a different procedure of payment by farmer produce organization or agricultural cooperative society by whatever name called, linked with the receipt of payment from the buyer. So on the same day payment has to be done or within 3 working days.
So that's the mandate which has been provided.
Yes.
Okay. The next question we have is that to Mr. Shankar, is there a freedom from mandi under the law and so that the farmer can choose any options which is convenient to farmer at any level?
The basic, my dear friend.
I think that's the main objective.
My dear friend, I'm glad you asked this question. Let me put it in simple language for you. The very objective of promulgation of this particular law is to make sure that the farmer gets the right of choice to sell his product in the market at his own convenience and not to be subjected by the domination of mandis or the politics behind it. कि भैया मंडी ने तय किया कि ये रेट होगा तो तुम ये रेट पे बेचोगे. नहीं, अगर तुम्हारा प्रोड्यूस 100 रुपए में बेचता है लेकिन मंडी तुमको बोले 80 रुपए में बेचो तो तुम 100 रुपए में बेच सकते हो.
That's the objective.
So, clear on this.
Okay. The next question we have is that I'll combine these two questions. Does an ordinary farmer have time and resources to go through bureaucratic 3-level of resolution? And the second question is, ADR is a good concept and we should encourage it, then dislodge it from unknown settlements that are happening in the mandi. And it's a good move by the government, but we should have effective rules. What's your say on that?
Yeah. So now, my dear friend, when it comes to supporting the farmer, well, the farmer today is a very informed person courtesy digital revolution, number one. Number two, there are people around him who will be working around him. And there is a farmer produce organization, FPO. 10,000 FPOs are being created all over the country to protect the interest of the farmers vis-a-vis including cooperative societies.
Right. I just want to add just one thing to this question.
Yeah.
Is the dispute resolution mechanism to avoid arbitrary acts by some vested parties against small farmers is the third question. So these are 3 questions.
Let me put a counter answer to this. My answer is that today, if the farmer is negotiating for a price that he deems fit for the sale of his produce, he's also able to go through a cooperative society or an FPO. And the FPO can negotiate on his behalf, including create a written farming agreement, which will be a contractual agreement governed by the Indian Contract Act. And the Indian Contract Act is subjected to violation, can also be sought in a civil proceeding.
Exactly. So we have the same question. Will Indian Contract Act be a corporate lifeline for agriculture now on?
No. The option of getting a corporate is to give a better fair price to the kisan, as also scale up the quality of his produce. But the final word will also be with the kisan, that the kisan also is entitled to produce his right, is also protect his right, sorry. Because the kisan is able to negotiate through an FPO or a cooperative agency that how, which price he should get, which nobody wants to talk about. All they want to talk about is MSP.
Wow. Okay. So you are saying the power is shifting from APNC to the individual farmer.
Exactly.
Okay.
उसको हिंदी में बोलूं तो मंडियों में जो दलाल होते हैं, दलाल जो काम करते हैं, जो सामान का जो रेट तय करते हैं, तो ये जो मिडिलमैन का जो क्लचेस है जिसमें किसान फंस जाता है और उसको इफेक्टिव प्राइस नहीं मिलता है, तो वो प्राइस जो है वो अब इंडिविजुअली किसान आइदर गवर्नमेंट बेस्ड पोर्टल पे और इंडिपेंडेंट फार्मर पे और एफपीओ तय कर सकता है या खुद नेगोशिएट कर सकता है वो.
Absolutely. And the last question, we have many questions. We have political questions also coming in. One question is to Mr. Shankar, in your opinion, will digital trading bring accountability to the unaccounted trades? Is that the objective of the government?
See, good question. See, understand one thing. India is evolving as a nation.
Yeah.
Indian economic setup is also evolving. Indian economics is also evolving. Indian infrastructure is also evolving. Indian lifestyle is also evolving. Now, many of us now see the world has changed so much. Generally, what do you mean by a conference? 200 people sitting and listening to somebody speaking on a podium.
Right.
Okay. Today, by this Zoom app, we are speaking to...
And Facebook. And your Facebook. Life.
We are speaking to multiple people and trying to explain them the import of this law.
Right.
The same applies to the farmer. The farmer gets a better deal to negotiate his price on the internet portal. Now, like say for example, if you have to purchase a product from Amazon or Flipkart, you go on the website, you click, you press the button, you add to the cart, and then the cart proceeds for billing, and then you put your credit card number, and then you bill and the product is shipped to your place. So the same applies to a farmer. Suppose if he wants to sell cherry, tomato, strawberry, aloo, tomato, he can go on a portal listed ki ye price hai bhaiya, ispe main bechunga, aur jisko khareedna hai, woh apna card laga karke khareed lega uska saman. Perishable or non-perishable?
Simple? Absolutely. I have last two questions for you from the essential commodities bill.
You can ask political questions also, no problem.
One question is, so under the essential commodities amendment, there's a provision that to remove commodities like cereals, so and so from essential commodities list, it will do away with imposition of stockholding limits on such items, except under extraordinary circumstances like war. The question is, what was the purpose of this amendment? Was it to dislodge the hoarding and price rise where we had incidents like onions, which suddenly go up to rupees 100 a kg?
Now, this is a multifarious question.
Yes.
It is, does not deserve a simple answer. I will have to revisit the law.
Yeah. So the intent of the law was that there were some mandis or some vested interest who will stock a lot of things and then price hike. Is it to address that issue?
Let me just reread this law again in your context.
Yeah.
Then we'll dissect it.
Okay.
In Section 3 of the Essential Commodities Act 1955, after subsection 1, the following subsections shall be inserted, namely 1A. Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1, A, the supply of such foodstuffs, including cereals, pulses, potato, onions, edible oil seeds like vanaspati ghee and oils, as the central government may, by notification in the official gazette, specify, may be regulated only under extraordinary circumstances, which may include war, famine, extraordinary price rise, and natural calamity of grave nature. Now, the conditions for which the government will decide to regulate the pricing of all these commodities, includes the basic commodities which my learned friend is asking, will only be done in these conditions, which is war, famine, extraordinary price rise, and natural calamity of grave nature like corona. Other than that, if an urgent situation is not arising, that where there is speculation that large scale hoarding might take place, let's say, for example, we end up having a war with Pakistan or with China, and there is massive infiltration of troops in our countryside, that it is a situation arises that India might be bombed sometime, and there is an apprehension that the cost and prices of all the basic commodities will scale up, shoot like a rocket, then the government will step in to deregulate and regulate all these prices.
Okay, that's the objective.
Yeah.
There is a second question on essential commodities, where the feature was to bring investment for farm infrastructure like cold storage and modernizing food supply chains, which is, I think, awaited for long, long years now.
Yeah.
Were you referring to 1991 from the perspective of FDI and foreign exchange in India? And will this be governed under the FDI laws?
See, what is the essential intent of the FDI? Foreign direct investment.
Right.
What does it mean? Let's break it word by word. Foreign direct investment. Now, say, for example, if Tesco wants to come to India, which it did, facing opposition. Say, for example, you have Walmart. You have Wegmans in the US. They want to come to India and start operating a chain of retail stores, grocery stores. Now, the nature and the extent of investment that they wish to make in a country can differ from the level of money they want to pump in developing their business. But any company which comes as a part of an FDI enterprise has to fall within the parameters of the Indian legal setup. The Indian legal architecture governs all the trade practices that completely defines the content and nature of any commercial transaction, including the one for essential commodities, for contractual obligations, for commercial transaction, for sale and purchase of goods, including setting up of companies, registering a company in an ROC, and subsequent formation of that entire business. So that depends on a case-to-case basis.
Okay. Final two questions. One coming from the farmer agreement on price assurance bill. The provision is that farmers can enter into a contract with agribusiness firms, processors, wholesalers, exporters, or large retailers for sale of future farming produce at a pre-agreed price. The question is, will there be a timeline for contracts like 5 years, etc., and will it be mutually agreed?
Let me revisit the law again in this context.
Okay.
I can explain it to you verbally.
Yeah.
Let me read the law once.
It's spoken about 5 years.
Yeah. A farmer may enter into, this is chapter 2, clause 3, sub clause 1. A farmer may enter into a written farming agreement in respect of any farming produce, and such agreement may provide for A, the terms and conditions of supply of such produce, including the time of supply, quality, grade, standards, price, and such other matters, and B, the terms related to supply of farm services, provided that the responsibility for compliance of any legal requirement for providing such farm services shall be with the sponsor or the farm service provider, as the case may be. Two, no farming agreement shall be entered into by a farmer under this section in derogation of any rights of a sharecropper. Explanation. For the purpose of this subsection, the term sharecropper means a tiller or occupier of a farmland who formally or informally agrees to give fixed share of crop or to pay fixed amount to the landowner, for growing or rearing of farming produce. Number three, the most important point, and this will answer your question. The minimum period of the farming agreement shall be for one crop season, or one production cycle of livestock, as the case may be, and the maximum period shall be 5 years.
Oh, so maximum is 5 years. Otherwise, it's a one crop cycle.
Minimum is the, but maximum is 5 years, that for 5 years, you can secure yourself as per the law.
Okay, so that answers to that. The final question we have is,
just to conclude, yes, on this point, provided that where the production cycle of any farming produce is longer and may go beyond 5 years, in such case, the maximum period of farming agreement may be mutually decided by the farmer and the sponsor and explicitly mentioned in the farming agreement. Now, say, for example, so the law also gives you the liberty to extend the farming agreement beyond 5 years also, subject to the condition of sponsor and the farmer mutually as agreeable.
Right. So there's no overriding restrictions on that.
Of course, not at all.
Absolutely.
The rights are protected.
Absolutely. The final question we have is on the law, Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Bill 2020.
Yeah.
Is the law attempting to provide freedom to farmers by creating an ecosystem where farmers and traders enjoy the freedom to sell and purchase farm produce outside registered mandis under the state's APMCs or so? Is that the intent of the law? I think you have said that. You can repeat that.
Well, my dear friend, to answer your question very briefly, today's India is a different India. It's an India of tomorrow. It's not an India of yesterday. And we need to start reforming where it is required the most, which is the farming community. And therefore, the fact that these three laws have been promulgated, the fact that essential commodities like pulses, dal, cereal, everything have been deregulated, and the fact that the laws specifically give a time framework for the work suitability of an agreement between the farmer and the sponsor of the farmer is itself a large scale revolution with a flexible mindset that anybody can approach to sell their product outside the purview of the APMC, including no produce area has been defined, no selling area has been defined. So it's a very broad and a very clear-cut vision-headed law that no shackles can stop you, no shackles can stop your growth, and you are at will, at your power, to do complete transformation of your own independent business as a farmer.
I think we'll take the cue from the word freedom itself, what you expressed in so many words. For the audience, we are coming to close here. We have got a lot of questions and all that, but we have a 2-hour session. We have to wrap up in the next 5 minutes. I want to first thank Shri Aditya Shankar, Advocate Supreme Court of India, for enriching us on the real farm laws from a legal perspective. And this was very insightful. As from a lawyer's perspective, the preamble, the legislations, and the intent is always in the words of law. And when courts of law interpret the laws, it is based on the legislative interpretations of the law.
Exactly.
We once again want to thank you for your immense time and efforts to explain the three farm laws. And to close it again, in the words of renowned statesman and late former Prime Minister of India, Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji, who said once, Indian democracy's greatest strength is that we have always put the nation above politics. And I think you, by explaining the law, you have put what was the intent of the law to put the nation before it. And we all stand for this democracy. And therefore, it is said that the constitution and the law will always prevail. And this is what the law we wanted to let you know as an audience. Thank you once again, Shri Aditya Shankar, for giving us time for this particular session. Thanks so much to my audience and to everyone for joining us today. Thank you, and we close the session here. Thanks again.
Thank you to the team at Lex Witness for organizing such an informative session. And I'm very grateful to my dear friend Zameer and all the other people at Lex Witness for giving me this opportunity. Thank you once again. Look forward to interacting on and on again. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, Mr. Shankar. Thank you so much, Zameer sir.
Thanks
for Lex Witness. Thank you so much, all the attendees. We will now be ending the webinar. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.